Long before we could launch probes toward distant planets, before we could use state-of-the-art computers to track the movement of the stars, even before we had telescopes to help us look deeper into space, all we had to explore the universe was our eyes. For thousands of years, ancient astronomers studied the night sky just by looking up, and they learned more than you might expect. Today, we'll explore how the work of astronomers across history guided everything we know about the solar system, and why they've spent over 2,000 years figuring it out. Astronomers have been trying to understand our place in the universe since prehistoric times. Early on, they had tons of theories. Some believed that the Earth was a disk and the sky was a dome with all the stars on it. Others thought space was more like an endless ocean with the Earth, sun, moon, and stars floating in it. They also noticed patterns in space that helped them predict eclipses and the movements of planets. They just didn't know how any of it was connected. About 2600 years ago, astronomers in ancient Greece began to put all these observations together to create the first models of the universe. Their earlier versions included a cylinder-shaped Earth and giant wheels of fire, but believe it or not, they were on the right track. Remember, these early astronomers didn't even have telescopes, but what they did have was math. And a lot of free time, so they quickly started correcting their mistakes. For example, there's a common misconception that, until fairly recently, people thought the Earth was flat. But thousands of years ago, these ancient Greeks used geometry not only to prove that the Earth is a sphere, but even to calculate its exact size. Then, in the 4th century BCE, a philosopher named Aristotle suggested that the spherical Earth must be at the center of the universe. This idea is called a geocentric model. Aristotle's geocentric model suggested the Earth stayed still while the moon, sun, planets, and stars moved in perfect circles around it. The geocentric model made sense to people. After all, it does look like the sun, moon, and stars are all moving around us here on Earth. But a model of the universe with Earth at the center didn't explain everything. Aristotle's model said that the planets all moved around the Earth in perfect circles. But as astronomers observed the planet Mars, they noticed something. Sometimes it appeared to be bigger and brighter in the sky. Other times it looked much smaller and dimmer. How do these observations prove that the geocentric model can't be correct? Pause the video here and record your thinking in your guided notes. If Mars were moving around Earth in a perfect circle, then it should always appear to be the same size and brightness in the sky, since its distance from us wouldn't change. But because it varies in how big and bright it looks, astronomers realized that Aristotle's simple geocentric model couldn't be right. In answer to this, a Greek mathematician named Aristarchus said, "Everybody, I think it's the sun at the center, not Earth." But that idea sounded so wild that everyone ignored him for a few hundred years. So even though it had some flaws, Aristotle's geocentric model was pretty widely accepted until around the year 100 CE, when an Egyptian mathematician named Ptolemy took the geocentric model to the next level. Ptolemy had a theory that each planet moved in its own small circle, while those small circles moved in bigger circles around the Earth. It's a lot of circles, but it did explain some things that Aristotle's model couldn't, like why planets sometimes appeared to move backwards in the sky. And Ptolemy's model was pretty good. It could even predict the positions of planets and the timing of eclipses. But Ptolemy's model still left some questions open. It just took another 1,500 years before anybody got the world to listen to their answers. Nicholas Copernicus was a Renaissance mathematician and astronomer who thought the geocentric model just didn't add up. In the early 16th century, he proposed a completely different model. The heliocentric model, where the sun, not the Earth, was at the center. This has been acknowledged as the first true model of the solar system as we know it today. A solar system consists of a star, like our sun, and all the objects that orbit it. Planets, moons, asteroids, comets, and more. And unlike when Aristarchus suggested it, people thought this model made sense. Think back to our Mars situation, for example. How does a heliocentric model explain why Mars appears to change in size and brightness? Pause the video here and record your thinking in your guided notes. Well, if Earth and Mars were moving, that would account for why Mars looks different sometimes. While Copernicus didn't get it all right, for example, he still thought every orbit was a perfect circle, his heliocentric model was a huge leap forward in understanding the solar system. Now, the math behind Copernicus's heliocentric model made sense, but astronomers hadn't been able to prove it just yet. However, the proof came after the year 1609, when Galileo Galilei, an Italian astronomer, became the first to use a telescope to observe space and record his findings. He was able to see details in the night sky that no one had ever seen before. His observations of the sun and the planets around it confirmed the heliocentric model beyond a doubt. It took people time to come around to this huge shift in thinking, but Galileo's discoveries eventually became the foundation for our modern understanding of the solar system. From Aristotle and Ptolemy all the way to Copernicus and Galileo, every influential astronomer's ideas had one key thing in common. Can you think of what it is? All of them were building on the ideas of the astronomers, philosophers, and mathematicians before them. Aristotle and the early Greek astronomers introduced us to the idea of a structured model for the solar system. Then Ptolemy refined it to explain new observations. Copernicus changed the structure altogether to fill in the gaps in Ptolemy's theory, and Galileo built on those ideas to guide his observations. In other words, scientific discovery isn't just about being the first one to notice something amazing. It's also about recognizing that we don't always get it right the first or second or hundredth time around. In fact, the process of making a scientific discovery often involves questioning what we think we already know. And sometimes we learn amazing new things along the way. So, after Galileo proved Copernicus's model of the solar system, we knew how the planets moved, but we still had no idea why. There had to be a pattern or a rule behind it all. Plus, that idea of perfectly circular orbits still didn't seem quite right. There was one huge missing piece. And in our next lesson, we'll see how two more scientists, Kepler and Newton, tackled this riddle with a surprisingly simple answer. Gravity. Until then, be sure to complete the practice questions and extension activities to learn more about how observations made thousands of years ago, with nothing but the human eye, guided our understanding of the cosmos today. And always remember, you are out of this world. Hey, hey.